Thank you, Ian, and good morning, everybody. And I guess for this audience, I should also add I have an undergrad degree in wood science and wood technology from the University of Hamburg. So what I want to do today is follow up on the question that was asked about carbon and the interaction between carbon and forests and buildings. And I want to speak about the role of the forest sector in climate change mitigation. I should acknowledge right up front that this is the effort of a large team of people, both in the Canadian Forest Service, but we also work with resource management agencies in all provinces and territories. We work a lot with the United States Forest Service, Mexican Forest Service, and many others in the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, et cetera. So it's really the effort of a large team, and my name is up front here, but I have pictures at the end of the many of the team that are contributing to this big effort. So 2016 was the hottest year on record. Again, it was the third time in a row that the last year was the hottest year on record. And in fact, February 2017 is also at near record highs again. This is a map of the world it was in February 2016 compared to the 30-year climate average. And what you see is consistent with what the Swedish scientist Svante Arrhenius predicted would happen, and he predicted this in 1896. He said that if we add greenhouse gases to the atmosphere, we would get warming on the Earth, and we will get more of that in the north and in continental regions. And this is exactly what we see. Canada is both in the north and in continental regions, so this is an issue that is of great concern to us. These are data, and as you can see, that the long-term, the monthly average was already in the 4+ degrees centigrade increase range. And this is entirely consistent, again, with what the projections are, but these are projections for the last two decades of this century, and we're already starting to see these kinds of temperatures today. The left is a map of the world it could be by 2080 to 2100 if we proceed on a pathway of low emissions and emissions reductions. The right is the world that we're heading towards with current emission rates, a world in which global temperatures will be significantly warmer and even more so in the north and in continental regions. What's driving all this is largely the addition of various greenhouse gases to the Earth's atmosphere, the most important of which is carbon dioxide. Since 1990, increases in carbon dioxide emissions have increased by nearly 50%. We're now adding 36 billion tons of carbon dioxide to the Earth's atmosphere every year through the burning of fossil fuels. Now, there is a little bit of good news in here. If you look at that graph carefully, you will notice that the last 3 years, the rate of emissions increases has leveled off. So we're still adding 36 billion tons of carbon dioxide to the Earth's atmosphere every year, but at least the rate of increase has diminished. And we can actually thank China for that, because it is the country that really has turned things around right now in terms of their rates of emissions. Unfortunately, the emissions is not necessarily an indicator of the growth rate of CO2 in the atmosphere. We have observed the highest growth rate ever in 2015, and the preliminary data for 2015 was an El Nino year, so that's not entirely surprising, but 2016 was not an El Nino year, and we still see similarly high increases in the Earth's atmosphere. The good news is that only about 50%, in fact, over the last decade, only about 44%, of the carbon that released to the atmosphere from the burning of fossil fuels and deforestation, that is the conversion of forest to non-forest land uses, remains in the atmosphere. And the reason the airborne fraction is less than half is because the remainder of the carbon dioxide is taken up by oceans and by forests. In fact, if it were not for the contribution of these two Earth's system components, the rate of increase would be twice as high than it is right now. And that, of course, would be big trouble. Knowing how oceans and forests will continue to operate as carbon sinks in the future is therefore a critical research question, because if we were in a situation where forests would start to become carbon sources, then we have a very different future scenario than if we maintain strong carbon sinks in forests around the world. In 2015, the United Nations Framework Convention signed the Paris Agreement in recognition of the climate issues and set a very ambitious temperature target of trying to keep the Earth's global average temperature increase well below 2 degrees centigrade. We're currently at about 1.1. What's important for us right now is that over 100 countries in their intended nationally determined contributions, these are the submissions made to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, indicated that the land sector, and that is agriculture and forestry, will be making a contribution towards the greenhouse gas emission reduction targets of these countries. Canada, United States, and Mexico all indicated their intent to use the land sector, including forestry, to help meet these greenhouse gas emission reduction targets. The reason this is so important is, remember at the I showed you the choice of two worlds, the cold world, cooler world, and the warmer world. As John Holdren said a few years ago, that we have a choice. We can go to the colder or the warmer world. The three choices we have are mitigation, adaptation, or suffering. And what he means by mitigation is that we reduce the rate of CO2 emissions and keep CO2 concentrations in the Earth's atmosphere well below the 450 parts per million. We just surpassed 400. When I started this work, we were around 350. We're now past 400. It's the highest it's ever been in at least the last 20 million years. To get to that low emissions pathway, we have to have peak emissions from fossil fuel burning in this coming decade. And we have to, at the end of this century, have net negative emissions. That means that these goals by 2050 to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 50 or 80% are not anywhere near sufficient to reach that 2 degrees centigrade target. We have to actually have net negative emissions in the latter part of the century, which means we have to have more removals from the atmosphere through forests and oceans and agricultural systems than we're adding to the atmosphere through the burning of fossil fuels. And that means we have to come up with ways of removing carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. And the industry is recognizing that. There was an XPRIZE offered in 2015, $20 million to those who can develop new groundbreaking transformational approaches to converting CO2 emissions into valuable products. I bet we're all sharing the same thought right now. Isn't this what forestry has been doing for centuries? We're taking CO2 out of the atmosphere, and we're converting it into valuable products. What we need to do is make sure that the broader public and the policymakers better understand that role of forests, and what we can do as a community to further our contribution towards greenhouse gas emission reductions, and that's what much of my talk will be about, because 50% of the dry weight of wood is carbon. One cubic meter of wood, that's that cube here at the University of Northern British Columbia, contains about 1 ton of CO2, or it's about the same amount as is in a telephone pole, or about 350 liters of gasoline. What we've been doing for 27 years now is working on models and tools that allow us to quantify better the role of Canadian forests in the global carbon cycle. And I won't go through the detail of this diagram, but what you see are very large fluxes from the atmosphere into forests, large fluxes back out due to the decomposition of organic matter. You see associated transfers from live to dead biomass, from fires, insects, and harvesting. But we also see emissions from fires, and we see the transfer of carbon out of the forest to help meet society's demands. We have developed a model that's now used around the world. We just held last week our 25th training workshop. We've trained over 600 people from around the world. This is used in many countries, including Canada, by academics, by provincial resource management agencies, and others. And what we're doing with these tools, they operate from regional to national scales. We compile information on forest inventories and growth and yield. We obtain data on natural disturbances, forest management activities, land use change, kind of has a deforestation monitoring program, and ecological modeling parameters, and we combine all this for 634 management units. The number keeps changing because we keep redrawing boundaries and maps, but basically what we do, we define the managed forest for greenhouse gas reporting purposes, and then we report to the United Nations information such as this. This is last year's data. The 2017 report will take a different format, but that will be released in mid-April. But fundamentally, what we see here is on the x-axis, the years from 1990 to 2014, the last reporting years, we see the area affected in the bars by forest management, fires in red, and insects. We see as the blue line, the sink or source of carbon dioxide. In this case, it's a sink in almost all years, if we look at just the forests. So the forests remove 250 million tons of carbon dioxide in the early part of the decade, maybe around 100 million tons of carbon dioxide per year from the atmosphere. But some of that is transferred to the harvested wood products. And so the second line with the X's shows you the net balance after accounting for the sink in the forests and the storage and release of carbon dioxide from harvested wood products. And what you see in this graph is huge interannual variability. You see the long-term trend associated with the mountain pine beetle in British Columbia. But you also see that in some years, even after accounting for all the emissions from biomass burning, et cetera, we are a sink, and we have become a bit more of a source in recent years, largely driven by the increase and the impacts of the mountain pine beetle. What's important for us is that every year we harvest take out about 158 million tons of CO2 equivalent in the form of harvested wood. That's about 25% of the carbon dioxide that is emitted from all other sectors in Canada. And what we do with this wood is critically important. This is a picture from Sweden, a logging operation following a storm or windthrow. It shows roughly a million cubic meters of wood, which is about 250,000 tons of carbon. And what we harvest in Canada, as I said, is about 185 times this amount. With our work with the Intergovernmental Panel of Climate Change, as part of the mitigation working group in the fourth assessment report, we try to shift the emphasis away from what was discussed in the Kyoto Protocol at the time, which was simply all about how much carbon we store in forests. And we argued that instead of maximizing carbon in forests, we need to take a much broader view. We need to understand how the human use of forest ecosystems and the production of wood products and biofuels influences carbon stocks, but how also it influences our use of fossil fuels, which are, of course, carbon intensive, and other products like steel, concrete, and cement, all of which are very emissions intensive. And we need to understand how we interact with the agricultural sector, because expanding forests into agricultural land may increase fossil fuel emissions in the agricultural sector as production intensity increases through the use of fertilizers. So the argument went from, don't look just at how much carbon we store in forests, but look at how the land sector contributes to the atmosphere, and our goal needs to be to minimize the net emissions to the atmosphere. And for forests, this means in particular, how big are the substitution benefits? How much carbon do we avoid emitting to the atmosphere if we use wood products instead of fossil fuels or other products? The debate that we're facing, in particular with those who are arguing for a maximizing carbon stocks view, is that we have fundamentally two possible approaches to this. One is we can try to minimize human disturbances and try to allow forests to age and take up more carbon. But we all know that you can't stuff an infinite amount of carbon into forest ecosystem. Trees age, they will eventually start declining, they will become increasingly susceptible to insects and fires. And so one view is maximize how much carbon you have in the forest. You produce, and you can do that by harvesting very little, and that means you have little available for biofuels and wood products, and that means you have relatively higher emissions from fossil fuels and other products. The alternative view is, well, can we maximize carbon uptake? And that we achieve by having, on average, well-managed younger forests that are harvested, and we use some of that material for biofuels and wood products. And by having more of those available, we have, therefore, the opportunity to reduce emissions from other products and fossil fuels. So understanding what the substitution benefits is critical. And of course, it's not a binary world. There are many reasons why we want to conserve certain types of forest ecosystems. Carbon is not the only way by which we manage forests. So this systems perspective means that we need to pay attention to three issues. We need to understand how much carbon is stored in the forest. We must not make assumptions in life cycle analyses that the forest will automatically regrow and therefore all the carbon is carbon neutral. We have to understand and account for how much carbon is in harvested wood products, and we need to account for the changes in emissions through the substitution benefits, and we always do that relative to a base case. And by comparing the difference between the base case and the mitigation scenario, we can quantify the greenhouse gas mitigation benefits. We do this using an analytical framework that is based on some of the same tools that we're using for greenhouse gas reporting in Canada, the same data. We have this carbon budget model that keeps track of ecosystem carbon stocks, not only in woody biomass, but also in soils, in litter, and dead wood. We have a harvested wood products modeling framework. It accounts for emissions from biofuels and carbon and wood products and storage in those, of course. And then we have methods to estimate the substitution benefits using models that we've also developed to and what we're then comparing is the net flux under different scenarios. And I have at the back of the presentation a slide that gives you a lot of the references to all of this work. Here's one example that we published in 2014. Carolyn Smith, a colleague of mine in my lab, published this paper with based on the work that our team did, involving also some of the policy folks like Tony Lempierre. And what we looked at the national scale is what is the biophysical mitigation potential of Canada's forest sector. And I'll just stay very high level here. We looked at seven different forest management strategies, each compared to a base case, to the same base case, and then two harvested wood product strategies, again, compared to a base case. And what we observe, and what this graph shows you, is the cumulative emission benefit. A positive value is a good thing. It means that we have reduced emissions. A negative value means we have increased emissions. And I just want to highlight a few of the examples. So we compared two scenarios where we just modified how the wood is used in the wood product sector. In one case, we moved 4% of the wood that would have gone to pulp and paper and moved it to panels, 4%. In the other case, we increased the bioenergy feedstock, so how much of the wood went to long-lived, less wood went to long-lived products and more went to bioenergy. And you immediately see that you have a negative impact from the bioenergy scenario and a positive impact from the long-lived product scenario. If we reduce harvesting but increase the use of long-lived wood products, we get an even higher mitigation benefit. If we keep the harvest level but we increase the utilization, we increase the utilization, and by doing that we take more wood per hectare so we have a small reduction in the area harvested, we combine that with long-lived wood products, we get an even greater mitigation potential. But if we look at a portfolio mix where we take different scenarios for different parts of the country, because it doesn't make sense to do the same thing across the country, if we regionally differentiate, we obtain a cumulative mitigation benefit of over 1,000 megatons, over a billion tons of CO2 by 2050. So that's a very large number, and certainly there's a lot more work that needs to be done, but what it emphasizes is the importance of regionally differentiated approaches. Just yesterday, I presented this in Washington. It's part of a trinational work that we're doing with the U.S. and Mexico. We took the same framework and applied it to an area in Wisconsin. Five simple scenarios, three in the forest product sector, two, again, in harvested wood products. And what we find is presented slightly differently. So now this is, again, the cumulative mitigation benefit by 2050, but looking at it by the components that contributed to it. So let's take number one, which was the one where we shifted, in this case, 7% of the wood that would have gone for pulp and paper into long-lived products. We didn't change harvest rates. That's important. We made no change to harvest rates. In the examples one and two here, we just changed the way in which the wood is used, and we achieve a significant mitigation benefit in number one because we store more carbon in harvested wood products, that's the orange part, and then we achieve greater displacement, so in other words, we substitute emissions from steel and concrete, and we get, again, a larger mitigation benefit. So the black bar is the total. If you go to number two, you have the opposite outcome. There we used more wood for bioenergy, again, at the expense of pulp and paper. And we only partly, so what happens is we increase the emissions from the harvested wood product sector because we need to account for the burning of the pellets when and where they occur. So we have greater emissions from harvested wood products as a consequence, but we do have some offset because we use the bioenergy to offset some fossil fuels, but the net benefit is still negative. So very different outcome. If you look at scenario three, we increased the harvest for bioenergy. So in this case, in three and four, we changed the harvest rate. So in three, we increased the harvest. As a consequence, we lose carbon from the forest ecosystems. We have increased emissions from harvested wood products, in this case, pellets or bioenergy. We have some benefits through offsets, but again, the overall outcome is negative and quite significantly so. Four, on the other hand, is an example where we extended rotation lengths. We extended rotation lengths by 10 years. We also shifted 5% of the wood that would have gone to pulp and paper into long-lived products. And as a consequence now, because we increased rotation lengths, we also reduced harvest levels slightly because you grow bigger trees, but you harvest less frequently. So here, what you get as the outcome is increased carbon storage in the forest. You get increased carbon retention in harvested wood products. You get a small reduction, a small penalty because you produced somewhat fewer wood products, so you have a slight displacement penalty. But overall, you still come out ahead with a substantial mitigation benefit. And the third study was just published a few weeks ago, is a big study we did for British Columbia, and I won't go into the details. It's very similar conceptually in the approach that we did, but what we added here is thanks to Tony's efforts and that of Zanju, who was a postdoc with Pacific Institute for Climate Solutions Forest Carbon Management Project and is now with the Ministry of Forests, Lands and Natural Resource Operations in BC. And what that study showed is that we can achieve, by 2050, 35% of the BC emission reduction target through the forest sector at a cost of less than $100 per ton of CO2, and we have additional socioeconomic benefits such as employment, et cetera. And this is, again, a portfolio approach with regionally differentiated strategies across the province. So the good news is that the understanding that the forest sector can play a role in climate change mitigation is increasing. The province of British Columbia just announced a $150 million forest carbon initiative. They're waiting to hear about a federal response to that, so there may or may not be additional funds going towards that. But the key is there's the first of potentially more provinces, because we're in similar discussions with other provinces, that are starting to recognize and act on the recognition that the forest sector can make a significant contribution. For this audience, cutting through all the science, what you need to understand are two important aspects of how we use wood. One is we need to understand the carbon retention time. The longer we can keep the carbon that was removed from the atmosphere stored in wood products, the better off we are. The second is the displacement factor, or the amount of avoided emissions through the use of wood. So take bioenergy. Bioenergy is in the lower left-hand corner. You have a short carbon retention time because the pellets will be burned quickly. You also, depending on what it is that you're substituting, you may or may not actually have a beneficial impact on the atmosphere. And then we move our way through longer-lived products like paper, packaging, and panels, and ultimately we get to where we need to be: structural building products. And why are they so important? Because we achieve the highest mitigation benefits if we can use wood that goes into long-term storage and, while doing so, achieves the greatest possible mitigation benefit. And you heard the previous speaker, this message is getting across. The building, the Wood Innovation Design Center in Prince George, was the tallest building in North America until recently. We now have the tallest wooden building in the world, the Brox Commons building in Vancouver. And we have numerous examples of other beautiful wooden buildings that are being built with new technologies developed in Canada and elsewhere. by companies that are really pioneers in the process of building complex wooden buildings. Of course, climate change is and will be affecting our forests, and we need to be mindful of how climate change impacts may interact with our mitigation strategies. I want to emphasize, and I say that with trepidation, not all climate change impacts will be negative. We will have, at least for some periods of time, beneficial impacts of climate change on forest growth, on productivity, but this is regionally differentiated, it's temporarily differentiated, but what is important for us to understand is where, when, and how climate change impacts will express themselves in the forest. It doesn't make sense to invest into aggressive silvicultural and forest enhancement activities in an area that may be very strongly affected by climate change in an adverse way. So if you anticipate high mortality rates, then maybe trying to keep those trees alive is an inferior strategy to harvesting after mortality and then making sure the next generation starts growing quickly with the appropriate species. So understanding the interaction of climate change impacts and the design of regionally differentiated mitigation portfolios is really important. So let me wrap this up with sort of some take-home messages. First, 10 steps towards forest sector carbon mitigation. The first is we need to grow trees, more trees, faster, and find ways to increase carbon stocks in the landscape. And you are predominantly forest product users and manufacturers. Make sure that those who supply you with the wood demonstrate that they're certified, that they are sustainably managing their forests, because if there's a perception that the wood that we're using is not coming from sustainably managed forests, we're going to have issues with the public and the consumers. And there are tremendous opportunities in forest management to do better than we are doing right now. And we need to find ways to implement some of those actions. Canada has a very low deforestation rate. We only deforest about 35,000 hectares per year. Those are the current estimates. Out of over 300 million hectares of forests. But the emissions associated with that are still significant, and there are opportunities for reducing those further. And of course, deforestation, avoiding deforestation globally is the number one issue for the forest sector. How we use the wood matters. Using it first for long-lived products. We need to maximize the carbon retention in harvested wood products, and we need to maximize the avoided emissions through wood use. As I showed you earlier, that also means reducing wood waste at every stage. And we shouldn't be burning residues in slash piles or other wood waste unless we find ways to capture the energy associated with that burning. We need to anticipate climate change impacts and align mitigation and adaptation objectives. We need to monitor the consequences of management actions. There's a lot of talk now about forest carbon initiatives and investing money into changing the way we manage the forests for carbon benefits. It's critically important that we put in place monitoring programs that allow us to establish what the baseline would have been, what the projected outcome of the mitigation action is, because that will allow us to design the most effective mitigation portfolios, and to have in place monitoring programs that show what actually occurred so that we can go back to the public and the auditors general later and say, here's what we invested, here's what would have happened, here's what did happen, the difference between what would have happened and actually happened is your carbon mitigation benefit, and here's what it costs you per ton to achieve that climate change mitigation benefit. If we don't do that, we will not be able to maintain the public support. You can just envision the script of some disinterested or opposing party, you know, going out, finding some example of a failed mitigation effort, dragging it all over the media and saying, look, they have no monitoring program, you know, it's just a boondoggle, we're wasting taxpayers' money, we don't want to go there. You know, we need to make sure that what we're doing has a strong foundation so that we can continue to get public support for climate change mitigation strategies, because to get to the long-term goals, we need to do this on an ongoing basis. So in conclusion, when we talk about climate change mitigation portfolios, we need to understand that we need to look at carbon stock changes in forest ecosystems, in harvested wood products, and we need to account for the substitution benefits relative to a base case. When we do the reporting internationally, in the forest sector, we only get to report the ecosystem impacts and the harvested wood products impacts. The substitution benefits occur in the country that uses the wood, that could be us or elsewhere, and depending on what it is that we're substituting, the emissions may not occur here. If we import steel from China, that substitution, and we reduce that import, the substitution benefit accrues in China. If we're reducing cement that we manufacture here, then the cement emission reduction benefit is achieved by Canada. One other point on this, if we ship pellets to Europe, and you've seen the increasing statistics, if we ship pellets to Europe, under international reporting laws, the country that produced the wood is accountable for the emissions. So first, we have to report the emissions that occur as the result of burning of pellets, say, in Europe, as an emissions greenhouse gas emission impact in Canada. That's why the Europeans can say, well, it's carbon neutral. We don't have to account for the emissions. That's true, they don't have to account for the emissions because the wood exporting country does. And we need to raise the awareness of this because there are scenarios of energy use in Europe under the renewable energy strategy that anticipate 40, 60 million tons of carbon in pellets annually imported from North America. If we go that route, this will be added to our greenhouse gas emissions and will make it harder for us to meet our targets. Conversely, and I saw the presentation of the previous speaker who showed how much of the wood that we ship to China is used in concrete forms. Again, they are short-lived products. They're often burned after they were used. Imagine how different our carbon footprint would be if that wood that we ship to China were instead not in raw logs, but in cross-laminated timbers that goes into tall timber construction. Because then, not only do we get a different revenue, but we also have a long carbon retention in the wood product that we shipped and not the short retention. And again, so it would help our Chinese colleagues reduce their emissions from cement, and it would help us by increasing carbon retention in harvested wood products. The efficiency of mitigation activities varies among the types of activities that we implement, and it varies by region. There's no single strategy that is best everywhere in Canada, so we are looking at very carefully designed and quantified options for mitigation strategies. We also identified that the strategies that focus on substitution and harvested wood product carbon storage always make big contributions. And so this is important for us as the people who are managing the forests. We do not control the use of wood. We need to work with architects, designers, builders to make sure that we increase the lifespan of harvested wood products and achieve maximum substitution of steel, concrete, and plastics and fuels. Conversely, you who are using the wood, as I said earlier, need to make sure that your suppliers produce the wood on a sustainable basis, because then you can be reassured that the carbon sinks that were affected by harvesting can be sustained through sustainable forest management. Our numbers show that we can achieve substantial mitigation potential, less so in the very short term, but certainly in the medium and long term, and particularly by 2050. However, it does require that the implementation of strategies start soon and that they are sustained, and that means that requires investment. There are regional differences in terms of the disturbance rates, the ecology, the response to climate change, and the management intensity, and those will affect the choice of the most efficient mitigation actions. As I said, we need to design portfolios that anticipate climate change impacts and consider the contributions to adaptation. And lastly, as we try to move towards this better than 2-degree target in terms of global climate change mitigation and temperature increases, we need to recognize that the forest sector can make a meaningful and sustained contribution. But to achieve that, we need to have the public support that needs to be established and sustained, and that is increasingly a challenge. Over 80% of the population in Canada now lives in big cities. Their understanding of what happens in the backwoods is often limited, and informed by those in particular who are interested in stopping all logging. I think we need to find ways to continue to tell the scientific basis of this story and demonstrate that sustained wood use and retention of wood carbon and substitution benefits are all helping mitigate climate change. Thank you very much. Here's some pictures of the team at the CFS, at UBC, and in the Ministry of Forests. Publications are available here at the CFS bookstore, and here's some of the references that will be in the PDF. So with that, thank you very much, and happy to answer questions.
It's always nice to end a session on an upbeat note, and I think we've got enough time for questions, so let's start. Here we go.
Thanks, Werner. The work you do is very important for our industry. It's Michael Giroux with the Canadian Wood Council. So I want to talk about or ask you a question in the area of substitution of products in construction. So last week, the federal government announced its intent to go to or to affect codes, building codes, and or more specifically, the energy codes towards net zero ready buildings by 2030. So that is a energy policy or in support of the climate change objectives of the government, but it is not a CO2, it's not a carbon policy, it's just an energy policy. More interestingly and sadly to me and what we do is that it doesn't acknowledge any of the substitution benefits of early action in construction materials. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't allow for the acknowledgement that wood products today have embodied carbon in them, and nor does it acknowledge that, for instance, the alternate or competing materials have high levels of climate disruption associated with them. Why is it that that was missed, do you think, and is your department engaged in that conversation?
The answer to the last question is, I don't know why that was missed. And obviously, NRCan is involved in the energy sector. But I don't know why or if these things were considered and what the conclusions were. I think it is important for us to understand that there are two components to the energy use of a building. One is the construction side, and that's what I've been focusing on, although some of the life cycle analyses that we include in the substitution benefit also look at the second component, which is the sort of lifetime energy use. I think this is another example where we need to break the silos down. We need to work together, just like the forest management and the wood use community needs to work together. I think the same is true for, you know, the people who specify building codes for LEED and other, you know, energy goals. I think we're all striving towards the same goal, which is, you know, reducing emissions to the atmosphere. We just need to make sure that when we create policies that they're harmonized and that we don't start one body creating a situation that's actually a problem for the other in terms of the impacts on the atmosphere. And I mean, to me, I'm not answering the other part of the question. I mean, as I said, I don't know. But to me, one of those examples is the whole focus on bioenergy. You know, we have strong, strong lobbies for increasing wood use for bioenergy. And there are appropriate uses of bioenergy if you're in a remote community with low population density, with wood surrounding it, with off-grid, and you have to truck in the diesel to fuel your diesel generator, great displacement opportunity, great employment opportunity. Bioenergy makes a lot of sense, right? If you have wood use in buildings and you have waste wood, again, some of that can go to bioenergy. But starting to harvest green trees that could be used for other purposes and feeding them into a coal-fired power plant, you know, every study we show shows the negative impact. So again, I think there's a need for the wood users to come to terms with each other and arrange the use of this resource in such a way that we achieve the greatest mitigation benefits. And the same is true in the building sector and everywhere else.
Other questions? I have one, actually, and it's around the optimization of wood. And I think we can all agree that using wood for biomass is not the best use of wood. But however, one of the things that we have found is that in the manufacturing side of things, particularly in pulp mills, which are traditionally high energy users, we've used hog fuel and residues, which
absolutely.
Is quite legitimate, I
yep,
think.
Absolutely.
And that, I think, opens up the other point that we're in a sweet spot, I think, as a sector, in the fact that we are addressing sustainable forestry. Previous to that, we've been siloed, of the foresters working on their own thing, the forest engineers and harvesters doing their own thing, et cetera, all the way down the chain. We now, I think, have an opportunity to integrate that value chain.
Yep.
We can improve and optimize at the forest level in terms of adaptation and mitigation. We can go to carbon neutrality when we manufacture our products. Even in harvesting, we can be looking at biofuels, precision forestry, and all kinds of things that way. And then we get into the product side, which gives you the carbon capture and storage in wood products. You've touched on this, but are we prepared as a sector and as, let's say, a research community to work more closely together with the idea of let's optimizing all along that value chain, right from the forest all the way through the full life cycle?
Yeah, the kinds of analyses that we're doing in the research community right now are first and foremost designed to have the policy community, the wood products users, the manufacturers, and everybody else understand better what the alternative choices are, and that some choices will have a much stronger climate change mitigation benefit than others. So optimization, I don't think we're quite there yet. I know research is ongoing, actually here at Laval University and elsewhere. Sophie Damour and her team and others are doing this kind of work, value chain optimization. And so, yes, that is work that is ongoing. But, you know, at this point, there are very fundamental questions that we need to answer. We're not, you know, the decision on whether we move more wood into long-lived products or into the bioenergy sector are fundamental issues. And we need to understand what the implications are of one over the other from a greenhouse gas perspective, from a revenue perspective, and a cost perspective. And so, you know, optimization to me is the fine-tuning part. But at this point, we're really at the stage of, we need to lay out the broad strokes. And I see a massive lobby for bioenergy. I don't see a similar lobby for tall buildings and what the things that, from my perspective, from a climate change mitigation perspective, have far greater mitigation benefits. And yet, the bioenergy community is trying to run with that argument when they don't have the basis. Carbon neutrality is a policy decision. Scientifically, when you burn wood, you release carbon dioxide to the atmosphere, right? So carbon neutrality, to me, that term makes me nervous because it's an accounting artifact as a policy consequence. That's all it is.
Well, let's give him a hand of applause.
Thank you.